So let your heart and soul say yes. Hallelujah.
Yes, yes.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
You gotta tell God yes.
Tell him yes personal. On today. Yes.
The worship means nothing without a yes. Without obedience, it means nothing. If you're really gonna tell God yes, come on. Make it personal.
Make it personal. Oh, hallelujah. Make it personal to the Lord God. Yes.
Thank you, Jesus.
Yes.
My soul says yes. I'll do what you want me to do, Jesus. I'll do it, Lord. I'll do it, Jesus. I might have to give up some relationships, but my soul says yes.
Yes.
I might have to give up some things that I hold dear to me, but my soul says yes. You mean everything to me, Jesus. You're the first and foremost in my life. That's why
I'm
bless the Lord God.
Yes.
We bless the Lord, for he is awesome. You hear me?
Yes.
He is an awesome God, and there is nothing that is too hard for God. Welcome everyone to Ministerial Engagement talk show segment on the altar of God's revival. Today we're coming in worshiping the Lord God, praising him and thanking him, oh hallelujah, for just all that he has done through this revival and teaching us about the altar of God. Oh hallelujah, tonight is the night that we end part one of a three-part revival, and then we are going to go into a three-week, you hear me, I call it communion with God, to where God, we're going to be going before the Lord God for him to heal, to deliver us, for him to show us who we are, show us things that we need to improve on, to for us to go before the Lord God, not looking at this person, not looking at that person, but looking at ourselves and having God to show us that we can be put on the potter's wheel and made over. And so many of you may have questions. You may have things that you want to talk about. And so that's why God had today as a talk show segment. We're going to go over the word that's been taught all week long. There are going to be nuggets that the preacher and the teacher is going to come forth with, any additional nuggets for you that to help you to be able to become that vessel that God desires you to do. God wants to pour out. However, before he can pour out, he wants to clean us up inside. Oh, hallelujah. Amen. I love that song. And so before we go any further, I'm going to yield to Reverend Robert Buluma Sakwa, and he's going to do our opening prayer tonight. To God be all the glory.
Thank you.
Sakwa, I yield to you, yes.
God bless you.
God bless
Let
you.
Let us pray. Amen.
Amen.
Father, in the mighty name of Jesus Christ, Father, we exalt your holy name on high. We worship you. We reverence your holy name, O God. Tonight we bless you. Tonight we thank you, Father, for giving us such opportunity once again. We thank you, Father, for this ministry. O Lord, we thank you, King of Glory, for what you have purposed tonight, Lord. I know, Jehovah, Father, you are going to minister to us in a special way. Thank you, Lord, for our talk show tonight. Thank you for the minister who's going to minister tonight, yes, our brother Thomas. Thank you, God, for each sister. Lord, I know you have got a great mission tonight, Father. You're going to reach each one of us, my Father, in a special way. We welcome your Holy Spirit to minister to us. Open our hearts. Open our spiritual ears, Lord, so that we can hear from you. We can hear from you, O Lord. We are before you, O Holy Spirit. We are before you, O Lord, our God. Father, ready to hear from you. We are asking that, Lord, we may come down. Come to us, my Father. Lord, here we are. Have mercy upon us, my Father, in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. We bless you and we honor your name. Tonight, God, you are going to equip us. Tonight, Father, Lord, you are going to rebuke us. You are going to correct us and to instruct us in righteousness. Thank you, Lord God, because the Bible says that your word is a double-edged sword. My Father, tonight, you are going to pierce through us, O Lord. Father, we thank you, God, because the Bible says that your word is a discerner. O Lord, it discerns even our thoughts. Lord, we thank you tonight because your word is going to discern us, O God. Your word is going to pierce through us, my Father. The Bible says that it separates us asunder, King of Glory. Father, it goes through the marrows and the bones, O God. Separates us, my Father, the spirit and the soul, my dear King of Glory. We thank you tonight because of this divine word that you have prepared for us tonight. O Lord, our God. In the beginning, there was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. And the Bible says, the Word, my dear King of Glory, was I want to thank you for this very Word that it became flesh, O God. And tonight, my Father, It is the very word that God, you are going to speak to us, oh Lord.
Yes.
I remember in the beginning when God, you are creating the world, my Father, and the world was void, the world was empty, was a vacuum, oh God. And the Bible says, Lord, you spoke the word, King of Glory, and tonight you are going to speak the word, and your word is going to create newness in our lives. Your word is going to transform our lives. Your word, my Father, is going to heal us tonight. Your word, my Father, God, is going to bless us tonight. We thank you, Lord, for this divine word. We receive it with great joy in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. My Father, there is none like you, Jehovah Father. We welcome your Holy Spirit. We welcome your power. Come down, O Holy Spirit. Minister to us in a special way. Thank you for your healing. Thank you for your deliverance. Thank you, O Lord God, for opening our eyes. Thank you for the wisdom tonight. Thank you for the knowledge tonight. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ, we bless you, O God. Sanctify this altar tonight. As your servant stands on this altar to minister your word, use him mightily, anoint him, empower him. In the name of Jesus Christ, I believe and pray. Amen. Thank you, Jesus.
Amen.
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 Amen. Awesome prayer. To God be all the glory. To God be all the glory. Thank you, God. On today, God spoke to me and he gave me a prophetic warning. And the warning that he gave me, he told me to, it was detailed. It was so much that I sat at my computer and I started typing it. And so I want you to know to go there over the next few days and you will see it. However, it is regarding technology. And God says that the same as I gave you the warning of COVID to warn my people and to warn the people, he told me that he wants me to warn you of this thing that's going on regarding technology. Even on today, I haven't even gotten any notifications of not being able to share, but that's why it's so important that we have a relationship with God. I don't usually share to so many people in the tag, but God said, share to other people. So I shared it to about 15 people in the tag, and I understood why. Is when I tried to share it from Trinity Hour, I couldn't. When I tried to share it from Bonnie Foster, my Facebook page, I couldn't. I give God all the glory because God is doing something. However, what's so more important is that you look at it, the people that do or the technology, it's not coming against you. It's coming against God and the work of the Lord God. And he was giving that warning on technology. That's why it's so important that what God is doing right now regarding coming to the altar for each one of us to develop that individual relationship with God, that you can hear him for yourself. What's going to happen when something is going on and you can't call on the telephone, you can't go nowhere. Maybe your cards won't start or something. You're gonna have to be able to hear from God. That's why this revival and tonight's talk show is so important. And any questions that you have or anything that we can do to be able to help you to be able to hear God, let us know, because we're here today and we're gonna continue to go be able to come forth it with the help of the Lord God and as God ordains our path. Oh, hallelujah. That on today, I wanted to introduce the co-host on today, and that is Apostle Cynthia Lynn Davison. We call her Apostle Precious because Elder Prophetess Jeanette Little, she heard God say she's precious. And so we've been calling her Apostle Precious since then. And Apostle Precious is the co-host, and she's from Houston, Texas. And she is the pastor of Be Encouraged Full Gospel Ministry in Houston, Texas, and also the co-host here at Ministerial Engagement. And our new TV station is called Trinity Hour Christian Network, THCN TV, and we are running 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, and it's going to be year after year until God says differently. And so at this time, Apostle Precious, she's going to do the rest of the introductions. As she's given the introductions, y'all raise y'all hand, and each person just give a greeting, so that way they'll know who you are.
Amen. Amen. I have the blessed privilege to introduce our speaker for tonight, Apostle, Pastor, Overseer Thomas Dicker of Greensboro, North Carolina. Amen. God bless you, man of God. Amen.
Raise your hand. Also, I have raise your hand and let me say something.
Greensboro, North Carolina.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Also, we have a next panelist is Pastor Robert Buluma Sakwa, all the way from Eldoret, Kenya. He's also a pastor of Indalat Pifa Church in Kenya, Africa. Amen. Amen. Let him wave your hand and say something to us.
Amen. God bless you. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Also, we have the overseer of the visionary Apostle Prophet Bonnie Foster in Charlotte, North Carolina. Amen. She's the founder of this great ministry. Amen.
To God be all the glory. Oh, hallelujah.
Amen. Amen. And last but not least is Evangelist Missionary Mother Gracie Morgan. Amen. Amen. God bless you, Mother.
And we do want to go out and say hello to our other co-host, Elder Prophetess Janetta Little, who's not able to be with us here tonight. However, we know without a shadow of a doubt that the anointed woman of God is keeping us lifted all up in prayer as we go forth. That's what love is. That's what's unconditional love. And we thank all the other Team Jesus members that are not able to be with us tonight. Apostle Maria, she just got out of church. And I do want to let y'all know that it's like 1 o'clock in the morning there in Africa. And at where Apostle Alicia is, it's like 1 in the morning. She's been in church having services. And so we are still all Team Jesus, and we thank God for all of you. Yes.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. And at this time that I do want to say that Apostle Thomas Dicker will be bringing forth the word of God. And as he brings forth the word of God, he's going to bring it forth with might and the power from heaven above. Oh, hallelujah. And then he's going to make a call, altar call out to the people. However, first they're going to play a song. And we want y'all to worship the Lord God. And we don't know on any rights to the song that's being played. And if you haven't shared, share during this time, because you don't want anybody missing what's going to help them. It's time for them to come to the altar. Mm-hmm. Thank you, Lord. Yes. God. Thank you, God. Thank you, God. Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, God. He's awesome. You're in all of his grace. You're in all of his goodness. You're in all of his mercy. You're in all of his provision. He's great, and he's greatly to be praised. Hallelujah. Come on, everybody, lift your hands as we lift our voices. Come on, say, my God is awesome. Come on, say, he can move mountains. Keep me in the valley. Come on, say it, hide me from the rain. That's it. My God is awesome. Heals me when I'm broken. Strength where I've been weakened. Forever he'll reign. Come on, you got it. My God is awesome. Come on, say, he can move mountains. Keep me in the valley. Hide me from the rain. Has he ever covered you? Come on, my God is awesome.
When I'm broken.
Strength where I've been weakened. Forever he'll reign. One word. Come on, everybody. My God.
My God is awesome.
Come on, somebody lift your voice. Yeah, my God is awesome. Listen, today I am forgiven. His grace is why I'm living. Somebody ought to praise his holy name. Come on, you say, my God. Come on, awesome. You said, he's mighty.
Amen. Praise God. Amen. Hallelujah. Yes. Glad to be here before you all. Let me first give honor to the Father God, the Lord Jesus Christ, my Savior, the powerful presence of God, the Holy Spirit, whom is the head of my life. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Amen.
Greetings to everyone viewing. I come to tell you God loves you so much. So much. If you only knew how much he loves you, God loves you. That's key reigning in my spirit. Every time I get ready to come on, every time I get ready to preach, witness, tell him I love him. God just says, tell him I love him. That means no matter where you are in your life, in your season right now, good, bad, up, down, or indifferent, God loves you and he wants you to come home. All he asks is that you just forgive yourselves and come on home. Amen. He already paved the way.
Amen. Amen.
Praise God. This is an opportunity, and I'm so excited about the revival. I've been doing great things, getting great reviews, and everybody's been bringing forth what God has placed in their heart. And this is such an awesome subject, the altar of God. Amen. Amen.
Amen.
And giving honor to my apostle, Ellis McKeithing Church of God in Christ out of Fayetteville, North Carolina. Amen. 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 Giving honor to all the lay persons that are here tonight and that's watching. Amen. Giving honor to, of course, the founder of this ministry engagement. Amen. Prophetess Bonnie, you know, I like to say Bonnie. Prophetess Bonnie, the mighty woman of God, Charlotte, North Carolina. Amen. Being viewed, hallelujah, televised around the world now. God bless you through streaming. Amen. And honor, amen, to her co-host, co-founder. No, sorry, not co-host.
Amen.
Pastor Davison, amen, out of Houston, Texas. And she has a ministry called Be Encouraged. Amen. Mighty, fresh woman of God. Amen. Called giving honor to Missionary Davis. God bless you. Amen. Pray.
Morgan. Yes.
Right. Yeah. Give me Mark, Miss Morgan. Amen. Mighty woman of God, also out of Charlotte, prayer warrior. Prophetess Elder Janita, who's not with us tonight. Amen. And of course, Pastor Sakwa from Kenya, Africa. God bless you, brother. He communicates me a lot. God bless you. Amen. Amen. He's doing a mighty work over there, I see, too. Praise God. Thank you. Thank you for all you mighty people of God. Also, shout out to Pastor Penny in Ladder, South Carolina, over there doing a great work. My girl right here in Greensboro, and also by way of Atlanta now, Prophetess Nakia 6, amen, of Jerusalem. Amen. Deliverance in the Holiness Church. God bless her. Well, greetings to all of them. I'm running out of breath trying to get you all. I know I missed. God loves you. I love you. And I'll just mess up more names in more places. So I'm going to say, bless you, all the lay persons. God bless you. All my friends. I love you. Down to my heart, not to my mind. Amen. Amen. Well, vice versa. Amen. Amen. So tonight, we're doing part two. Amen. Of God, the consuming fire. And dealing with the altar of God, dealing with what happened and when the commandments of God was disobeyed and God and the altar desecrated, God sent his prophet to send justice on a nation that was desecrating his holy altar. Amen. Amen. So with that said, we're going to go to first. You know what? I want to pray first. I'm doing a little different. God, we thank you. We bless you for tonight. We bless you for this word, God. We thank you for all those that are here tonight, that are sitting on the panel, God, to answer, hallelujah, by as the Spirit leads them, God. We thank you for the people who are going to ask questions, God, that it be sincere from their heart, something they want to know. No question, hallelujah, is the dumb answer. No question is dumb, God. The only one is the ones that they don't ask, God. And so we're here to answer, and we're here to be your voice, God, tonight, your mouthpiece, God. God, I just pray, God, that you move by your Spirit, that you bring peace, God, a sweet peace, God, anointing and refreshing, understanding for all of us tonight, God. Lead by your Spirit, using for your glory. In Jesus' name, we thank you and give you all the praise, all the glory, and we praise you, God. Amen. I give thanks.
Amen.
Let's go to 1 Kings chapter 18. Just going to read a few scriptures, so I'm not going to cover as much as I did last time. We're going to start at 1 Kings chapter 18, verse 30. 1 Kings chapter 18, verse 30. And it reads, Elijah said unto all the people, come near unto me. And all the people came near unto him. And he repaired the altar of God that was broken down. Elijah took 12 stones according to the number of tribes of the sons of Jacob, unto whom the word of the Lord came, saying, Israel shall be thy name. And with the stones he built an altar in the name of the Lord, and he made a trench about the altar as great as wood could contain 2 measures of seed. And he put the wood in order and cut the bullock in pieces and laid him on the wood and said, fill 4 barrels with water and pour it on the burnt sacrifice and on the wood. And he said, do it the second time. And they did it the second time. And he said, do it the third time. And they did it the third time. And the water ran about the altar he filled the trench also with water. And it came to pass at the time of offering of the evening sacrifice that Elijah, the prophet, came to him and said, Lord God of Abraham, Isaac, and Israel, let it be known that thou art God of Israel, and that I am thy servant, and I have done all these things at thy word. Hear me, O Lord, hear me, that this people may know that thou art the Lord God, and that thou hast turned their heart back again. Then the fire of the Lord fell and consumed the burnt sacrifice and the wood and the stones and the dust, and licked up the water that was in the trench. And when all the people saw it, they fell on their faces and said, the Lord, he is Lord. The Lord, he is God. The Lord, he is the God. Amen. Amen. Praise God. Yeah. And from that, as before we pick, continue with the title, God is a consuming fire. But you know, I like to kind of give you a contextual understanding. So I like to go back a few chapters and just bring you up to speed. We're talking about in chapter 17 that in the book of Kings, God speaks to the chief prophet Elisha and declares a 3-year rain drought on Israel for breaking his commandments, for their abominations of whoring after other gods of the pagan nations, God Baal and Asherah, gods of fertility and God of rain. They're calling on these names instead of the God of Israel for tearing down his altar among many sinful other acts they committed before him. And we discover in chapter 18, as we come into chapter 18, the 3-year drought is ending. God sends Elijah to meet King Ahab, amen, of Israel. Now, King Ahab had betrothed Jezebel, the pagan nations of Zeridans, as his queen. Jezebel was despised by God. Jezebel taught and influenced King Ahab and the nation of Israel how to worship the pagan gods Baal and Ashtoreth. The Bible says that she had 450 prophets of Baal, and she had 400 prophets of Ashtoreth that sat at her table. These were the images made by hand and stood up tall and high for the people to look upon. And they worshiped these things to the point where the prophets, the priests of these gods, would cut themselves and blood would gush out, and they calling on their names. They did all types of sinful commitments to these gods and acts and rituals. It was just very terrible, very, very violent scene, actually. But they continue to do these things, and she learned it from her nation. That's why God said, don't mess with other nations, because they were pagan nations. They worshiped other gods. He didn't want that infested into Israel. And when they married those other nations, that is exactly what happened, what he told them not to do. They did. You know how you can tell your child not to do something, and guess what they do? Go do it anyway. And so they get the results of that, and they come back and tell you, you were right. You know, amen. So here we are again. Now, the Lord God, Yahweh is what God is called, is his name. We translate in Hebrew. We translate it in English to Jehovah. And Jesus told him at the bush, when Yahweh was there at the bush, God said, tell him that I am that I am. Moses said, who should I tell him sent me? He said, tell him I am that I am, because God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit is one. He's a compound God in one, and he functions as three personalities. And he said, they just won't understand me. So you tell them, I am sent you. I am that I am. I can't explain myself, because you won't understand it. He said, I am that I am. And so he consumes, amen. He consumes, amen. He's God of fire. I think it was the prophet Isaiah that saw him sitting high up on a throne, and he said that there was a flame going up from his waist up, back and forth. There was a flame he saw. It was inside his body, because God is invisible. He's spirit, and that's why we call him Holy Spirit, because you could see through him, and he was able to see the flame that was going and roaring up in God back and forth. See, he's a consuming fire. Amen. And the Bible says he was the first one to light the altar of sacrifice. He said after 7 days of their celebration, dedication of the temple, that on the eighth day, God lit the altar himself. Amen. So he's a God of fire, and a God of fire because he consumes everything. He consumes all your sins. Amen. He consumes all your troubled passes. He cauterizes and heals all your open wounds caused by your hurt of life, abuse in life, your rape, abandonment, all those neglects and things that you were rejected. God consumes all that. He cauterizes it with his fire. Amen. And he heals you to make you good for the work of the kingdom so that you can go out and witness and tell them about the goodness of the Lord. Amen. For he is a consuming fire. Yahweh is a healer. He is the author of our faith and the bishop of our soul. Amen. Hallelujah. To his name be the glory. Now, we established that Jesus fulfilled, amen, the ultimate sacrifice. Amen. The Bible says that Jesus entered the most holy place once for all by his own blood, thus obtaining eternal redemption. Now we enter the same way through his precious blood, for he made a way for us. Jesus became the ultimate sacrifice. God always required a lamb of perfect health without any sickness, no blind eyes, no crookedness, nothing wrong with him, no sickness. He had to be a perfect sacrifice, and he had to be valuable to you. See, these were a lot of times these shepherds, they were shepherds, and they had animals. And he said, I want your best. Bring me your best. And you know, a lot of times when God asks for your best, in today's society, we would call it your money. Touchy subject. God said, I want your best offering. And you said, well, Lord, I don't know if that's still relevant to today. I don't know. You know, you struggle with that. You struggle with giving. You struggle with giving him because God wants your best. Amen. Because he's the Lord God and he deserves your best. And with your best, he's able to bless you because you open your hand. Amen. So the Leviticus, amen, priesthood taught us that it had to be a good offering, a valuable offering, a wonderful sacrifice to God. Amen. And so Jesus fulfilled all that because Jesus walked this earth without sin. Amen. He was God reincarnated in a human body. He came down as a spirit. Amen. He was seated at the right hand side of the Father, but he obeyed God, came down, humbled himself, put on this old dirt suit. Amen. And became a man, a living human being. And he walked in humbleness before God and obeying his will, doing his will. Amen. And he died at the cross. And he said, I come for this, to die for your sins. Amen. And see, Jesus never sinned, but on that cross, he became sin, because the Bible says anybody that hangeth on the tree become a curse. Amen. So he became a curse for you and I. He became a sin for you and I. But the Bible says he took away our infirmities. He took away all our sickness, all, amen, everything we had to pay as a penalty for sin. Jesus took that. So by faith, amen, we are forgiven. When we believe that Jesus done that for us, we're forgiven. Believe it in the heart and confess it with the mouth. Amen. So the altar of God is now a place of repentance. That's what it was about. It was a place of repentance. It was a place for forgiveness. And it was a place of restoration and building a relationship with God. So now we say the altar of God is what? Prayer. The altar of God, we reach God through prayer, through communion to God. Amen. That was a physical shadow and a symbol of what it would take but to cleanse our sins and our guilt conscience. Amen. And Jesus fulfilled all that. And to the point now that our altar is where we spend time in prayer. For the Lord God dwells in us and we pray to him in spirit and in truth. Amen. For he is a God looking for such. Amen. Now our judicial system says this, you know, we have to keep the commandments of God. And our judicial system says this: if someone is guilty of a criminal offense by decision of a judge or court of law, the conviction must be a punishment by law. Amen. That's deemed by law. to justify the offense, even to the sentence of death. Depends on what you've done, what crime you've done, what law you broke. Amen. If your punishment was not dealt with, you're still considered an escape from justice. Amen. They're looking for you. You're wanted. Amen. Because you broke the law, you did a crime, and you have not been caught yet. So you're fleeing justice. You're running around, but your name is posted till you get all the way to the top 10 most wanted. You could be the most wanted in North Carolina. You could be the most wanted, amen, by the FBI around the world. But you're going to have to answer to what you've done for those sins. So somebody has to pay the penalty for your sin. And Jesus did that for us. Thank you. Just put it, think about it. We broke the laws of God, and Jesus paid that penalty before we were born. Amen. He's already done it for us. Amen. That's how wonderful and easy and how much God loves us. He fulfilled everything. He was perfect in every way. So the altar of God is now prayer. Amen. And so we spend time with God, communing with God. Amen. Desecrating his altar is what a lot of people have done. This is what they done when Elijah had to send judgment upon him, because God's altar is holy. We got to be careful who we're praying to. Amen. We cannot take his altar and put him second. See, this is what he judged them for. 10 commandments. The first one is, thou shalt have no other gods before me. We cannot be praying to devils and demons. We cannot be praying to our ancestors. We cannot be praying to heads of organizations. We cannot be praying to things that have nothing to do with God. We have to be careful in how we spend time at the altar and who we spend time with at the altar. The altar is holy and it is sacred. Amen. It's a sacred place of God. It's very sacred. You know, the book of Malachi says, from the rising of the sun, even to the going down of the same, my name shall be great among the Gentiles. And every place incense shall be offered unto my name, and pure offering for my name shall be great among heathens, saith the Lord of hosts. Enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. Amen. See, you're entering the holy place. Amen. Holy, most holy place now because of Christ Jesus. You enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. You know, a little while ago, we was having a little technical trouble. And I said, sing us a song, Pastor Davison. She began to sing and worship. We begin to worship. Bonnie came back on, began to sing. Amen. And guess what? Oh. My Africa started, popped up. Everything. You got to praise them. You know, you got to enter the holy place. Okay, there's too much confusion. Let's call on God and let's thank God. Let's worship him by faith anyway. Let him move it. Let him work. He said, when the praises go up, the blessings come down. Amen. So we can enter that.
Technology worked.
With a place of prayer. Hallelujah. We can give thanks to God. We can give praise to God. We can give worship to God. He says, by everything in prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, present your requests to God, and the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. See how peaceful that is? You know, people used to ask me, how do you get to be so, why you don't get upset? I said, because I believe I serve God and I'm doing right. And if God don't answer me, then it's already done. You know what? So I just give him praise and I give him honor and I give him glory. Amen. So I pray. And you know what? And spending time at the altar, I've learned something about being at the altar. Amen. Praise God. You learn his voice. You're not going to learn his voice if you're not communing with him. Amen. You learn his voice. And that way you don't listen to other voices. Amen. You don't listen to every form of doctrine because you learn his voice and what his will is. Jesus said, those who know my Father know his will. Amen. So you got to spend time at the altar. It is most important. There's no way you can build a relationship with anyone. Guess what? If you ain't spending time with them. Listen to this. One of the most reasons failure of marriage, not the reason, but one of the most dominant reasons failure of marriages is because lack of communication. Or better yet, they don't know how to communicate with each other because they don't spend enough time with each other to understand each other. You know, so that is a failure. And if it's a failure in your marriage, then it's a failure in your marriage with God. Amen. because you got to spend time with the one who created you, the one who's guiding you, the one who's leading you. If you're going to do his will, if you're going to be used for his glory, you got to know his voice. You got to know. You know what? Somebody called me the other day. I can't remember the name right now. But I said, I recognize that voice. I knew who it was. I knew the voice. I may have been out. I don't know. But I recognized the voice. And I didn't have to see him. I said, I know your voice. They said, how do you know it was me? I said, your voice. I know your voice. Amen. So spending time in the altar of prayer is so important, folks. It is so important. God's requiring us, hallelujah, to be in a situation where we can spend time at the altar. Don't be so busy trying to fulfill, hallelujah, worldly needs and worldly desires and pleasure and miss the most important things. You know how many people tried to do that? And in the end, they said, I wish I'd have spent more time with God. Even to today, I wish I'd gotten saved earlier and filled with the Holy Ghost that I could serve God more. If I knew it was this wonderful, you know, we thought we was missing something. That's what it was. We thought we was missing something. We didn't want to come all the way in. You know, we just wanted to know because they said we had to know. But we didn't want to give God all our stuff because we had some pleasures. We still wanted to boogie at the club. We still wanted to get our drinks on. We still wanted to do some other things we hadn't been doing. But God wants all of us. Amen. We must come to God, hallelujah, as a holy and acceptable sacrifice. Amen. He said,
preach.
By the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto God. That is your reasonable service. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Be not conformed to the world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove, listen to this, what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. Mm-hmm. Amen. So Paul sums this thing up, that statement he'd been teaching about how to walk, how to talk with God. He sums it up in that teaching, in that one statement. He says, be a living sacrifice. That is to be committed to the things of God. Committed, yes. Not halfway in, yes. Not halfway out. Yes. Committed to the things of God. Amen. Your worship, your talk, your walk, your thought, your ways must be like God. Bring all things into subjection. Amen. Obedience to the Holy Spirit of Jesus Christ. Because we always saying, I ain't there yet. I ain't there yet. But the Bible says, bring everything into subjection unto the obedience of Christ. Amen. You're to submit yourself a living sacrifice. Amen. It is no good for you, amen, to put on, amen, nice clothes and go to church. And on the inward side, you're all messed up because you haven't been cleansed. That's one of the first things you need to do before you can get into the presence of God. Amen. Amen. You know, 300 years prior to Christians being established as Christians in Antioch, they were called the way. The followers of Jesus was called the way, or believers, because they did the way of Jesus. Amen. The way of his teachings. Amen. To be humble, to be loving, to be kind, to be meek. Amen. He did, they call it the way of Jesus. The followers of Jesus was called the way. So we must yield, amen, to God, for God is a holy God. I can't say that enough. It means that God is unstained, untainted from sin and evil. He is perfect in every way. Everything he does is perfect and good. Amen. He is sacred and holy. So the moral barometer for us is his 10 commandments. Mm-hmm. And that's why he's chastising Israel, because they broke the first one. Do not put no other gods before me. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
We're to measure ourselves up with his commandments. They're a reflection of his nature. Jesus said, a new commandment I give you, love your neighbor, I mean, as yourself, and love God. Amen.
Amen.
Paul said that they're summed up with these two. Love God first and love your neighbor as yourself. And he said, when you do these two, you keep the 10 commandments. Because think about it. If you love someone, I mean, love them from the heart, you're not going to steal. You're not going to harm them. You're not going to go after their spouse. You're not going to steal from them.
Thank
you. He's saying, if you love, which is the royal law, treating everybody as you would want to be treated, you're not going to do anyone wrong.
Mm-hmm.
Amen. So we got to think about these things as we approach God. God is a God without sin, and he requires us to walk in holiness. He requires us to walk in sacredness. He calls us to be set apart, amen, amen, from the world. Not agreeing with the world, but be different from the world. We're in the world, but we're not of the world, amen. So we have to be right. Now, coming up to speed, chapter 18, verse 17, 18, the reason God sent the drought is given to King Ahab through the mouth of the prophet Elijah. Upon meeting the prophet Elijah, King Ahab accuses him of causing the rain drought. He said, and he says, why have you troubled Israel? And prophet Elijah said, I haven't troubled Israel, but you and your father's house, amen, because you broke the commandments of the Lord by following the pagan god Balaam and Asherah. And here's where it gets interesting. Amen. This is going to be my first point. I want you to write this down. I believe you said Pastor Davison already covered it. I'm going to touch it again. Do not desecrate God's altar. Amen. Do not desecrate God's altar. Desecration is the act of depriving something of its sacred character. Amen. Being disrespectful, contemptuous, or destructive treatment of that which is held to be sacred or holy. If prayer now represents the holy God's altar, it is a sacred place where we meet God. It is not to be replaced by any wannabe, amen, gods. It's an abomination, folks. I've already said you cannot worship demons and devils and fallen angels. It is an abomination to God. You remember God said when that abomination sits in the holy place, amen, then Christ will soon come. And he's talking about the devil raising himself up, sitting in his seat, saying that he is God, amen. But we have to be careful in breaking that first commandment. I know a lot of us say it's gone, and we don't really have to believe it, but God punished the nation of Israel because they continually broke his commandment, amen. The book of Malachi says a son honor in verse chapter 1, verse 6 to 10, a son honor for his father and a servant, his master. If there be a father, where is my honor? This is God speaking. If there be a master, where is my fear? See if the Lord of hosts unto you, O priests, that despise my name, and you say, wherein have we despised thy name? You offered polluted bread upon my altar. They were supposed to bring fresh bread, amen, in the table of showbread every daily. Fresh bread representing his word, amen. And you say, where have we polluted thee? You offered blind animals to sacrifice. God wants your best. You offered up lame and sick. Is this not evil? You can't come to God in your mess. You're trying to get close to him. You got to ask for forgiveness. You got to ask to be cleansed if you want to get close to a holy God. Look, holy and evil don't mix. It is like oil and water. It will not mix. And God will not allow you to come that close. He will still deal with you, but he will not allow you to get as close as you can be. Amen. He wants you close to him so he can keep you, teach you, commune with you, and fellowship with you, and build a relationship so he can use you for his glory. Amen. Amen. Now, a challenge is put out by Elijah. This it gets good. It gets good. I call it the thriller in vanilla. The Thriller in Vanilla Part 3, a fight, amen. Elijah the prophet challenges Baal prophets to a fight. This is judgment coming down on Baal's prophets, amen, for tearing down the altar of God, amen, and raising up a false god. And now God is jealous. He wants his title back, amen. They done even went and left him worshiping other gods. And these are his people. He's upset and he wants his title back. Amen. So Elijah declares, amen, we're going to fight about this thing. And he says, the meeting place is going to be in Mount Carmel. We're going to fight. Get your tickets. I want all of Israel ringside. It's going down. Bring Baal prophets, all 450 of them. It's going down. And it's just me and you. I represent God. You represent Baal. And it's going to be a fight. And one of us that represents the real God is going to live. The other one is going to be destroyed because this is what God does, amen, to disobedience, amen. and sinful people who continue to worship other gods when he's called them and told them the truth. Amen. I mean, who can win against God? Amen. Yeah. Who can challenge him? Amen. Can anyone make the sun rise? He told Job, can anyone feed the young lions? Amen. When they cry out, does anyone know the depths of the deep? Can anyone make the stars sing? Can anyone tell the proud ways where to stay perpetually and go no further? Hallelujah. Only the God and creator of heaven and earth. Amen. The God of hosts, the Lord of armies. Amen. Of angel armies. Amen. He is awesome in every way. Hallelujah. He's a jealous God and there'll be no gods before him. He's all wise, all knowing, all powerful. His first commandment, thou shalt worship no other gods before me. And the day of the fight, Prophet Elijah is in the challenge corner representing the God King Yahweh. Amen. And in the other corner is the world's champion, 450 of Baal's prophets representing the world, the pagan nation of God Baal. Amen. Amen. Do you remember the fight between Evander Holyfield and Mike Tyson?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I remember that.
And look at here. Something unexpected happened. Holyfield comes in dancing to the song, I Shall Dance Like David. I said, good God, what's going on here? He comes in the ring and he's draped, hallelujah, on the back with, I can do all things through Christ Jesus. I said, uh-oh, Tyson in trouble. he was praising the Lord. Amen. Oh, Mike Tyson didn't know why he hit him. Every blow he swung, it was like King David when he swung that slingshot and threw that rock at the giant. It was the spirit of God behind them punches. Oh, Tyson undefeated, knocking you out every 30 seconds. He didn't know what happened. He had gotten hit by power he'd never seen before. It disturbed him. He didn't understand. He got angry. So angry in the second fight, he bit him. He bit his ear off. God before you, who can be against you? You can't fight the spirit of the living God. Look here. They killed, amen, amen, one of the saints of God who was known for, amen, for working signs and wonders in the book of Acts, Stephen, because they couldn't refuse, they couldn't battle against the spirit of God which he spoke with, amen. It was wisdom. They had to lie and build and get people to lie against him so that they can find him guilty and just kill him. They want him dead because they couldn't fight against the spirit of the living God. God says, not by might that you do this. It's not by power that you do this, but by my spirit, saith the Lord. Amen. He wants you ready to do what he's called you to do. Amen. My second point, that brings me to my second point. Amen. God is a consuming fire. My second point, to minister at the altar of God at a church or church setting, the minister must be licensed by a holy ordained pastor. I say holy ordained. Amen. A holy ordained. He must be licensed by accredited pastor, by a pastor that has been licensed and ordained. Amen. Because this is the case. License. You may say, I'm called by God, I don't need license. But license says you have experience. License says you have been trained by somebody. And you know how to conduct yourself at the altar of God. You sat under somebody to learn how to work at the altar, amen, of God. Before you can receive your driving license in North Carolina, guess what you got to do? You have to go to a driving school course, take a course. You have to pass the state driver's license test. And guess, last of all, you got to get in that vehicle and pass a test that they give you. And what that says? That says that I'm an experienced driver. Amen. At least it says I know how to drive. You may not be experienced. At least it says you know how to drive. That's a requirement to drive. And guess what? So when you break a traffic offense and that trooper or officer walks up to you and he asks, the first thing he asks for is what? Your driver license. Because you said, I took a course. I was trained and I obeyed the laws, but you just broke them. So he said, let me see no license. And guess what? You can be receive an offense, a judgment, because you offended the laws of the state. Amen. The laws of the city. Amen. And so you receive punishment for that against your license. So God wants us, amen, to keep his commandments so that we, I mean, don't receive punishment. Jesus paid that price. So we're in a place where we can ask for forgiveness at the altar. When we come down there to pray, you know, Bonnie said one thing tonight, let's first ask for forgiveness, amen? Because when we come to the altar, you know, whether you sin consciously or unconsciously, you need to ask for forgiveness, amen? So that God can speak to you and use you in a mighty way. God don't work in no mess. I don't care what you say, how you say it. So one of the most important things is to be trained, amen? You need to pastors, your lay persons, your ministers, you need to give them training in class, but most importantly, on-hands training. I love the fact that to be there with somebody and mentor them when they're training, and you allow them to make mistakes. Don't interrupt them, but afterwards you correct them. Don't embarrass them because it could quench, you know, their spirit and they're not want to mention it. They're going to make mistakes, but you're there to correct them. That's the same thing as training a prophet. Training, amen, and apostle. Training somebody who's been coming new to a ministry, a position. You got to walk with somebody. You need to be licensed to work at their altar because there's many mistakes made at God's altar. And you remember Aaron's son, I mean, offered up a strange fire before God. And God struck him dead because it's considered a holy place. And I believe God wants to get back. And I believe that his presence is going to come that strong again during this revival. So we have to be careful and understand what we're to do and what we're not to do. So license says I've been trained. Amen. I may not be experienced as the next person, but I've been trained because I have license. Somebody licensed me to say that I met the qualifications. Amen. To work at the altar. Amen. But don't be no fly by night preacher saying God called me. I don't need license. You need to be trained to work proper ministry. So you can have that confidence when you go up to the altar to pray for someone. Amen. Because it is a place of prayer. Somebody comes to sacrifice their life to God. You don't want to mess that up. You want to know how to minister to them. Amen. So it's important. Be licensed. If you're not licensed, get licensed. Get under somebody, submit to them, get trained. Amen. To work the altar of God is very important. And I mean, we got many examples. Aaron and his sons trained, amen, in Leviticus priesthood at, amen, the tabernacle. And they trained others to work, amen, all the way to where John the Baptist was born. His father, amen, was a priest who worked at the tabernacle, amen. So somebody was training somebody else. I mean, you got so many examples of the Bible. You got Joshua. He trained under the prophet Moses, amen, how to serve, how to be a leader. For years, he trained under Moses until God called him forward to be a leader. He didn't even know he was training, but he was serving Moses. And Moses told him many things to do. Amen. He led the army many times, and he did much where God was able to say, okay, now Joshua can handle this because I'm with him. Amen. He exchanged, amen, the anointing. He transferred the anointing, but he served under Moses before he became leader for many years. The prophet Samuel, he served at the tabernacle under Eli. Amen. He sat at the holy place under Eli for many years and before he became a major prophet. Amen. Where God, they said that the Bible says that whatever Samuel said, God answered it. No word God allowed, no word to drop from his mouth. He was such a servant and a man of God. He was honored that much. And he, hallelujah, he gave and worked and gave sacrificial offerings in Shiloh at the temple of God. Amen. When the temple was in Shiloh, he was the head, amen, pastor there. He was the prophet of God. He was the head leader. He was the man. Amen. Samuel was a well-known, established prophet in Israel, but he learned how to work the altar, servant under, amen, the priest Eli. Amen. There are so many examples, folks. I mean, you know, Elisha. Elisha trained under the prophet Elijah. You know, he served under Elijah. And when Elijah was taken by the chariots of Israel, took him by the spirit into heaven, he dropped his mantle. The mantle was transferred to Elisha. Elisha picked it up and he began to immediately walk in authority and signs and wonders. He took the mantle, struck the water, and said, part in the name of the God that my master Elijah served. And the water separated and he walked across on dry ground over that river. Knowing who you are by serving somebody will help build your confidence. So it's very important that you humble yourself. You're going to have some good days and you're going to have some bad days, but you're going to learn. Amen. That's the moment. You're there to learn. You're not there to get it all into your feelings. Amen. To God be the glory. King David. Amen. That's a good example. King David served under King Saul. He was anointed as a child by the prophet Samuel and a teenager, but he served the king, amen, for years and years before he became king. He learned kingship. He learned politics. He learned how to rule over the people. He learned how to lead the military, which was very important. Him and Joshua learned that. And so he served, amen. He wasn't no fly by night, amen, king. He served up under another king and learned the ways of God. And he learned, hallelujah, the ways of the king. And he even was able to offer up a sacrifice. Amen. Being a prophet himself, he was able to offer up a sacrifice because he understood God so well. Amen. He wrote a lot of the book of Psalms. David was a man after God's own heart. Amen. Mighty praise. And all right, that leads me into point three. God says, when we come to the altar, come with the expectation. Come with the expectation for God to move and demonstrate his power. You know why? Because God wants to be glorified. It's not for us. Look how great I am, because we don't have that kind of power. We've been given authority through the Holy Spirit. It's the Spirit of God who works in the power, you know? It's the excellency of his power, amen, that he wants to show, amen? So come to the altar, amen? We have this treasure in earthen vessels that the excellency of the power may be of God and not of us. Amen. Of yourself, because he wants, amen, to show his glory. So when you come to the altar, don't just come up there. Amen. Just waiting. Come expecting God to do something. He wants to turn it around for somebody. You come to the altar expecting God to move the power. You got to have faith. You got to have expectation. If you've been in the altar of prayer, Jesus said, I do what I see my father do, because Jesus prayed all night. He disappeared and prayed all night. And when he'd come, he'd be doing signs and wonders so many they couldn't even write him in the books. They said the world couldn't even contain the books because he spent so much time with the Father and God showed him what to do. He wasn't surprised when somebody died. He wasn't surprised when somebody came up with a half a leg or was bent over or crippled. He knew what to do because he spent time with the Father and the Father showed him what to do. He said, today, maybe a Sabbath, but it's made for the man, not the Sabbath for us to serve. He said, when I see my Father work, I work. Amen. Praise God. He said, when you see him, you see me. And God showed me all things because I spend time with him. So you got to come to the altar with the expectation of God to demonstrate his power. Amen. Don't come up there, yes, la, 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 guy. You don't know what's going on. You spend time with God. You fast, you pray, you get ready, you go. And when God, and you spending time, listen here. You spending time at the altar of prayer. When you get up to the altar at the church to minister to people, wherever that place may be. Hey, it may be a place at your work where you got to pray for somebody. They just got hurt. They just had a heart attack and died. You spent time with God and you got to operate in faith. You begin to call on the God that wakes you up in the morning, the God that you know you're spending time with, the God that you know provides for you, the God that you've seen heal your sick child, the God that you know you've seen turn your neighborhood around, the God that you know save your husband, your wife, save your in-laws, save people that you never thought would be saved. On his spirit and by his spirit and by his power, you begin to call on his name. God is looking for somebody to operate in faith and boldness. But you can't build boldness if you're not at the altar of prayer, spending time with God. Because what you do in private comes out in public. You hear me? God said, amen. And I will magnify you in public. I will answer you. Amen. You got to believe that he can do what he said he would do. And so when you're spending time with God and he tells you to move, you're going to operate because you know his voice. You see, he recognizes his voice. Yeah. Amen. That's God. I obey that. And God can do anything. That's what you got to believe. He can do anything. And God said, lay hands on them and they'll be healed. Maybe God just said, speak a word. Amen. Just speak a word, because you got to understand it ain't about you. It's God moving by his power, and your obedience brings it to pass. Amen. You got to believe in your God, and you can't do that if you don't trust him. You're not going to trust him if you're not spending time at the altar of prayer. The altar of prayer builds relationship. It builds faith. It builds trust, because you're communing with your God and you know his voice. Amen. No other voice you recognize, and you will not honor it. But when your God speak, guess what you're going to do? That's God. And you're going to move when he say move. You're going to do what he says do, because you're spending dedicated, committed time in the presence of God. Amen. You got to have a prayer life if you're going to be effective in the ministry of God, if you're going to be effective in your family, if you're going to be effective, amen, in your church, if you're going to be effective in your workplace, you got to spend time with God. You can't be distracted, amen, by promotions. You can't be distracted by people talking about you. You can't be distracted, amen, by the enemy just bringing confusion left and right, medical stuff, children, amen, bills. You cannot be distracted, because your God is a provider. Your God is a healer. Your God is who he says. You know how you're going to believe it? Because you're spending time with him. No matter what that doctor says, amen, report are you going to believe? Amen. You got to be spending time at the altar of prayer. If you want to see change, if you want to see your ministry grow, you want to see your finances grow, you want your family healed, you want to get out of a situation you don't know what else to do, you got to begin to spend time with the only one who can answer you. It's not a temporary answer when he picks it. It's a perpetual answer. Hallelujah. God is all knowing, all wise. Amen. And he's waiting on you, all powerful. He is waiting on you to come to him so he can demonstrate his power. You got to know his voice, and know his voice, you got to spend time with him. A relationship falls apart. I love the two don't agree. You don't want to be at that altar of God, quenching the spirit of God, because you don't understand or recognize his voice when he's telling you to heal. That person that can't hear has been waiting. That mother's been praying for 20, 30 years now for that child to be healed. And one opportunity for you to cease and do what God has called you to do. But because you're not spending time in prayer at the altar, you cannot recognize his voice. And so you quench the Holy Spirit. And it takes a while to get him back, because he is sensitive. He is a gentleman, and he only comes where he's welcome. So you want to be very careful not to deny the Holy Spirit his opportunity to, hallelujah, hallelujah, his opportunity to magnify God. You want to be in that number. You want to be that person. Amen. That is Elijah. And in Elijah, they walked in the power of God, and Samuel, because they stayed with God in prayer. Amen. It's more important to spend an hour with God than an hour on that TV. You can shut that thing down. You ain't missing nothing. You're probably watching reruns. Probably done watching 17 times, and you're still watching. God said, come in prayer, child. I want to show you something. Something's coming up tomorrow. You need to know what it is. Something's coming next week. You need to know what it is. And then when it hits you, you're, oh, because you didn't spend time with him. And now you're mad at God when he kept calling you and optioning you to come. Jesus. We have to. Jesus. Have to. At the altar of prayer, he's made a way. Jesus made a way. He fixed it for you and I to come into the most holy place in the presence of God. I ain't talking about some far off view. You know, most of us are looking at heaven, waving at God. God dwells within us. He says he is in us, that the excellency of the power may be of God and not us. Amen. When you receive the Holy Spirit, he resides in you. Amen. He resides in you. I have laid hand on many people, and they started shaking and trying to hold back the Holy Spirit from their belly. He came up, and when he came up, he spoke. They spoke with another language. He dwells within you. He wants to be restored in his rightful place. Amen. Put him back on his throne. Let him have his way. Hallelujah. Give him his way. You got to give God his way so that he can be glorified in your life. Amen. Let it be known, amen, that God is God of gods, Lord of lords. He's a consuming fire. He'll take care of all that you're worrying about. He'll singe it up. He'll burn it up. Amen. He'll make it all right again. He is a consuming fire at the altar. When you call on his name like Elijah did, Elijah said, let the God that is God answered with fire. Amen. And God fell down, whoosh, and sucked up everything, burnt up everything. Just, it's gone, because he's the God that consumes everything sinful. Amen. Everything that gets in the way of God, he answers. Amen. So be careful at the altar of God. One, you want to be licensed. Two, come with expectation and expecting God to move by demonstration of power. Amen. The first, I think my first point was,
do not desecrate God's altar.
Not desecrate God's altar.
Yes.
Be very careful lighting candles and praying to your ancestors. Yes. There is in the Bible that it says you have to just
evil altar. Yes.
You're desecrating God's altar, calling on, I don't know, Casper the ghost and all these others may be answering. You may be hearing voices, but that's because you don't know your God's voice. You're answering them. Amen. You got to know God's voice. Amen.
Amen. Yeah.
That said, folks, amen, I'm going to close out right there. Remember, do not desecrate his altar. Amen.
Amen, amen. Man of God, after that, because of that, the in-depthness of it, can you go forth and do an altar call right now for the people that you got their attention, that they know that they've done these things? And then we're going to go forth on with the discussion segment.
Amen. Praise God.
Amen. Yes.
If you've done these things, you've called on your ancestors, you prayed to them for answers. You went to the witch doctor, the soothsayer. You built an altar at your house to somebody other than Yahweh, Jehovah, Jesus. You need to repent. Mm-hmm. It's a time of reflection. It's a time to repent while you still have breath in your body, because judgment comes for those who reject God. So you want to be in the right standing with God so he can still use you while you're on this earth. To save your family, to save many more, be a witness for him, kingdom, God's government, amen. So let us pray. If you've done those things and you're not in right standing with God, and maybe, hey, look, maybe you're just not with God and you've done those things, but we want you to get your heart right now. We want you, you've been waiting for this opportunity to pray to God, to submit to God. Let us pray, amen. And also all it says is believe in your heart and confess with your mouth and thou shalt be saved. He wants your heart. God is after your total commitment. Let us pray. Repeat after me. Heavenly Father, I am a sinner. I went against your commandment. I've broken down your altar. I've desecrated it. I've put others on it before you. I ask for your forgiveness. Lord God, I want you, number one again. If you will restore me with the blood of Jesus and his resurrection power, I thank you and I praise you and I give it all to you. Fill me with your Holy Spirit that I may worship and build an altar unto you in prayer, giving you all the glory and all the honor. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. 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 God, I cover everyone, amen, that needs this prayer. God, I cover everyone that's made this prayer. God, I ask you that you bless them. God, maybe they worship other gods unknown. God, but God, I ask you, God, to bless them with understanding. That they get strong by prayer and fasting and studying the word of God. That they may know you, who you are, and they may know your voice, God. They may know your presence. Amen. So we thank you. Close, Father. Jesus. Amen. Amen. Praise God. Thank you, God.
I don't know what that noise was. I think it was coming from you, Pastor Davidson. I muted you for a moment. I don't know. But I thank God for that word, man of God. You hit hard. You did. We're gonna come back because all week long we have not responded or had any type of the ministerial engagement, the engagement part afterwards, because God wanted us to come in preach, teach the word, do an altar, and go out. So we were obedient to the directions of the Lord God, because God wanted us to take that word. He didn't want anything said or anything to get us off. He wanted us to go right then and there for him to start working on us regarding the altar. It does not feel good all the time when a parent corrects us, that may chastise us, you know, set us in order, but is for we can do better, for us to give God all the glory, for us to have the altar right. When God said that his altars were being desecrated, he was disturbed about this, to say it lightly. He was mad, upset. And so therefore he gave us a charge, and that charge was to set the houses in order, to set it right. And so I thank God for each one that has came forth and brought forth the unadulterated word the way that God has told us. And now we're going and moving forward to the talk show segment, that this part, Apostle Davison and I, we're going to co-facilitate this portion. And this is how God had guided us to go about doing it. First, what I'm going to do is I'm going to give the date that it came, and that the speaker and the title. And then Apostle Davison, what she's going to do is give the key points to the word that was taught. We've had some faithful people to the Lord God. You hear me? Y'all have been here every day. You've been here watching. You've been receiving. Some of you have called. Some of you had questions and things like that. Today is the day that you get any additional questions or answered. If you have anything to say, I have put in the comment section a way that you can come into the Zoom room with us, or you can call on the phone, or you can go and put it in the comment section. So I'm gonna ask all of you that are up here, if y'all can pay attention to the comment section, because I have up another screen. And so if y'all see a comment that somebody has, let me know, and what we can do is we can go back and address it. However, though, after I give, this is your thing again, after I give the speaker's name is in the title, Apostle Precious is going to give the key points. And then what I'm going to do, whoever preached, you will have 2 minutes to add anything additional, or if somebody has any questions. And then we will open it up if somebody else has a nugget or something that they want to say or to add to it, or anything. So the speaker, the clergy, the ordained man or woman of God will have 2 minutes to add anything, or if anybody else has anything to say, you'll have a minute. And so what we're going to do is that we're starting with on Monday. On Monday, we had Apostle Davison preach, and she preached on, I don't know what's going on, Lord God, bind up technology issues in the name of Jesus. In Jesus' name, amen. Y'all see how Maria, she talked about how we got to be the altar to be able to speak those things. You see how it just stopped instantly. I thank God. So I thank God. But on Monday the 8th, Apostle Davison, she taught the desecrated altar. And so Apostle Davison, can you give us the nuggets that was on that portion?
Yeah.
Go out and come back in. Go out and come back in. Because you are something's wrong. So what we're gonna do is that we're gonna go to Tuesday. On Tuesday, we had Reverend Robert Sakwa to preach, and he preached on dealing with the altar. The man of God, he talked about the altar has power of influence. He talked about how we have to sacrifice ourselves to God. He talked about there being evil altars. He talked about the holy altars, the evil altars. He even touched bases also on the ancestrals, like going and praying to your ancestors and those are evil. You don't do that. He talked about also that the identification, how to identify what is considered an unholy altar, a holy altar, and an evil altar. And so at this time, Reverend Sakwa, I'm going to yield to you. Do you have anything additional that, well, first I wanted to tell you, man of God used you. He used you mightily when you preached that word on holy and unholy altars, because many people may not have known the difference. And that's what God wanted, is for us to educate people on the holy and unholy altars and being able to identify it, that you helped us to be able to know that, because I even know some people talking about, I'm praying it to my ancestors. No, you don't do that. And then doing it within the house of God. And so God used you mightily, man of God. I done spoke my part, but I'm yielding to you right now for if God has given you anything else that you would like to expound upon, or anything else regarding the word, regarding the altar. I yield to you.
Thank you, servants of God. May God bless you so much.
God bless you.
When you read from the book of Proverbs 11:9b, the Bible says, but through knowledge shall the righteous be delivered. When you have the knowledge about something, then the Bible says, the righteous shall be delivered. We shall be delivered by the knowledge. And here we are talking about the altars. The other time I was talking about dealing with altars. What I can just add is that an altar is the power base, a fortress or a stronghold, and a habitat of spirits for both the kingdom of light and the kingdom of darkness. An altar is where the Bible talks of being a place where there is power, where power or a fortress or a stronghold or a habitat of spirits of both the kingdom of light and the kingdom of darkness. An altar is a strong gate. The gateway of spiritual realm through an altar is a gateway to every spiritual realm is through an altar. Thus, he who controls this gate controls the spiritual traffic in the environment. When you own an altar, it means you have the power to control. You have the power to control a certain territory. You have been given, you have the power to be in charge of something. The strategy of establishing a domination over territory is by raising a strong altar. Like the other time I talked of, and the altar encounters another altar. Man, as we are created, there are two altars that are in charge of controlling man: the altar of God and the altar of the devil. You must be on either one of them. The altar of God is an holy altar, is a righteous altar. Being in charge of a priest that fears God, a priest that honors God, a priest that has the standard of godliness. The satanic altar, it is vice versa. And when you raise an altar of God, you attract God upon your life. And I talked about an altar of God, or a satanic altar has to have a priest, has to have a sacrifice on it. The greater the altar, it means how much you devote yourself on that altar. Mm-hmm. How rooted you are on that altar. How frequent you sacrifice on that altar. When the altar you are built on, when the altar you are rooted on is weak, it means you are not devoted to it. It means you do not sacrifice. You do not keep the standard of that altar. And that's why God told you about the altar.
Yes.
Because at this time, the altar of God has been defiled.
Mm-hmm.
People serve two masters at a go. They want to please the devil and they want to please God. You want to find men of God standing on the altar of God, but they call the altar of God not with the God's agenda. They defile the altar of God. But God wants a righteous altar.
Yes, he does.
Altar that pleases God. And each and every time when you read about the Bible, men of God, in places they were going, they were raising altars. Look at Abraham. Abraham, to any place he went, he raised an altar. Look at Jacob, look at Isaac. They were raising an altar because an altar will always fight for you. An altar will connect you to God, your God. Either it connects you to the devil or it connects you to God. That's why I began by saying it is a power base, a fortress, a stronghold, and a habitat of spirits.
Amen.
That is an altar.
And it's so important too, because this is some deep information, and that's why I'm giving the dates, because I want you to go back and people that have not watched it, I want you to go back and watch it. And it was Tuesday, May 9th. I will be sharing all of the teachings again over on the days that we are out for 3 weeks. However, he has the meat, he has the potatoes, he's talking about the evil altars, he's talking about the sacrifice, he's talking, God is saying, oh yeah, that I see that he walked heavy in the apostolic anointing when he preached his word. Oh yeah, he says his servant, oh yeah, that I see. He says he knows. He deals with the evil altars. Oh yeah, that I see. And he's on a mission, oh yeah, that I see, to tear down the evil altars. Oh yeah, that I see. And he's given us the key. Oh yeah, that I see. Man of God, God is saying, let me write this down, that there's a second part, just like the man of God, he has a part two. He says that you have a part two to dealing with the evil altars, that you are to go in and to expound upon even more, because some people, they think that they can burn the incense. They think that they can do these things and still serve God. But God says that they're confused and they need healing and deliverance. So and so that's why it's important. Man of God, I have to open it up right now and stuff though. But right now, I'm going to ask you, do you have anything that you want to leave with the people that they can do for the time that we're out? based on what you said. And if you can sum it up in like about 30 seconds, and then I'm going to go to each person. And if you could give me about 30 seconds of what the people can do regarding what Apostle Sakwa said. So Apostle Sakwa, did you, to sum it up, is there something that the people can do right now? I think he's Fred. Oh,
thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you. Yeah. What I can say is that what people can do, just like the servant of God, Josiah, the Bible says when he began his reign, he studied the history of his father, David. And the Bible says he wanted to imitate David. He wanted to serve the God of David because David knew his God. And the Bible says, but his forefathers had raised other idols, had raised other altars in that land, had defiled, had abandoned God, had defiled the altar. And at that young age, the Bible says, he began by destroying the altars of his forefathers. Mm-hmm. He wanted to worship the God of David. So one thing that one has to do is by repenting. And repenting means to turn away from that direction that people have been going to, or you have been going to, you turn away from that. You turn away from worshiping those idols. And the Bible says, Josiah began by destroying those altars. Even Gideon destroyed those altars and raised an altar for God. So it begins by repenting. Start by doing what we call spiritual mapping. Identify what kind of an altar am I on? What kind of that altar? Then turn away from it, repent, and build an altar for God.
Amen. Amen.
Amen.
Y'all have it. God be all the glory. Amen. Identify, repent, destroy the altar, and then hallelujah. And go back and rewatch this. Rewatch all of it several times. If whoever has a comment that you want to add to it, instead of going to each one, just raise your hand if you have anything else that you wanted to add or say regarding the word on dealing with the altar. Amen. Man of God, I'm going to say again, it was an awesome word. It was. And I'm going to go listen to it again. Okay, let's go back to Monday. Monday, May the 8th, Apostle Davison preached on the desecrated altar. If you can give us a nugget, woman of God, on what that was regarding.
Amen. My first point was talking about idolatry, having symbols in the house of God. That's recognizing flesh, was recognizing people more than his God. I'm having idols, like maybe a picture of somebody having this item over here, item over there, and you're honoring things in the house of God more than you're honoring God. You're not honoring the God that let you make the things that you're honoring instead of honoring his altar. Next point I made was strange fire, bringing a strange worship into the house of God. Like the sons of Aaron, they got killed because they brought strange fire before God. And the next point I made was making God's house a den of thieves. Mm-hmm. You got all these things being sold in the house of God, in the vestibule, you know, in the sanctuary. You're selling stuff more than you honoring God. You're more concerned about selling books and tapes and CDs and having bakes and stuff than you are worshiping God at his altar.
Amen, amen. I just wanted to tell you, woman of God, God used you. Yes, he did. And it was an awesome word, the desecrated altar, the start off the on the revival list. She came with the fire from heaven above on that first day about idolatry, about the strange fire starters. That's what God, he had me talking. He mentioned it too. But then the den of thieves, one of the things that I want to go and say is that do the bake sales, do all of those sales, get a flea market, go and take it outside the church house and do it. So that way we can keep the house holy and sanctified. Go back and watch it. Go back and watch it. I'm going to yield to the rest of the clergy. And do y'all have anything to say or to add or nuggets regarding the desecrated altar? Raise your hand and we're just going to go to you at this point. Does any of the callers have, or anyone watching, do you have anything to say at this point? If you do, put it in the comment section. I don't see any comments right now. Do y'all see any? Okay.
No, ma'am.
Great. Then on Wednesday, May the 10th, we have MaryJo, Prophetess MaryJo Leek. She taught obedience at the altar. And I yield to you, Apostle Davison.
The first point is we can't use the word of God for our own purpose. We must be about our Father's business, and we must change our way of living. Those are 3 points that she made on that day. Amen.
Okay. I'm going to relate that to the altar, meaning that when you're at the altar and you're doing altar work, we can't use working at the altar for our own purpose or for our own glory. We have to stay focused on God's will and way, and we have to be about our Father's business. We have to be able to have a spiritual ear to hear. And she says we must change our way of living, meaning that we should not be partying and having people that are coming doing altar work that are partying and out and acting like unholy, unsanctified all week long, and then coming and trying to do altar work at the altar, trying to lay hands. You're spreading demonic spirits and warfare. And we're going to be going into that. We got some more speakers coming in that's going to be talking about the demonic activity that is going on, and that how, by us getting our temples right, how we're able to overcome those things and how to be able to cast out and pray. Is there anyone else that have anything that they would like to add, Apostle Davison, regarding obedience at the altar?
No comments on Facebook at the time.
Okay. Does anybody else have any comments? Okay. Now we're going to go to the word that I taught. It was on, I taught on Thursday, May the 11th, and the word of God was called Thursday, May the 11th, Keep God's Altar Holy. I wanted to preach on the Holy of Holies and, the inner and outer court. God says, no, he had me to come and teach his word because he told me to, and that because the altars were being desecrated. And so when I came forth, I talked about how the altar must be kept holy. Number two, that the watchmen of the house will be held accountable regarding the things that happen at the altar. We are going to be having some legal people come in, lawyers, that's going to teach on church law. Actually, I was an ambassador on Capitol Hill for the Congressional Black Caucus, and I attended the legislative conference for the Houses of God. There are a lot of churches that are getting sued right now. As the man of God was talking about their particular laws, those laws are in some states, in some cities, or however, but each person, each state, each church, and each jurisdiction are under different laws. So you have to find out what law you're over. And then there are federal laws also that we have to go by. And so that they differ. However, we're going to have legal people coming in that's going to be teaching about the church laws and that how, because churches are getting sued and they're paying out big dollars because of things that are happening at the altar that are unholy, that are not in alignment with the word of God. Then he gave me four parables that must not operate at God's altar. One of the things is God was saying to do, give the do's and the don'ts of the altar. How are we going to learn? How are you going to learn if we don't talk about the things that we're supposed to do and what not to do? When we're not talking, when we have to get the characteristics of what we are supposed to have. And so on the four parables that God gave me, he talked about the proud, prideful, and the self-glory seekers. Those that want to be seen and not give God the glory. Then he talked about the disobedient. We heard that a lot throughout the whole conference about the disobedience. And then those, also we've heard a lot about the evil altars, those that operate as a witch and warlock and under the satanic, the evil. They're doing evil at the altar. And then the recontaminators. The churches that allow people to be recontaminated after they receive their healing and their deliverance. There's people that after they get up, you got people running over them, touching them. And the God, and that's why we have to hear God. Because sometimes you don't supposed to touch somebody. And after a person receives prayer and deliverance, you got people going up there, can't wait to get their hands on them. So to recontaminate them, to reinfest them with demonic spirits. Then you got people actually that are laid down, slain on the altar. And they're laid there getting their healing and deliverance. And here comes somebody touching them, interfering with what God's doing, or pulling them up off the altar. And on this teaching, I'm giving specific examples of do's and don'ts that's supposed to happen at the altar. So go back and watch it also. And I open it up now to the clergy. If anyone has a comment or anything to say, raise your hand and we'll go to you. Nobody at this time. Okay, I'm trying to see, do we have any people that are watching? Okay, the last comment that I want to make on that is that our outside life must be in alignment with God. We can't be in church one way and outside another way. Mm-hmm. And we have to be able to say, it's me, God. And we have to be able to look at ourselves and stop looking at other people. We got to look at ourselves. It's a scripture, I believe it's in Matthew, is that you can't look at the plank, and you're always looking at somebody, you're not looking at the plank in your eye. Mm-hmm. We have to be able to look at ourselves. And so now we're going to Friday, May the 12th. We had Elder Prophetess Jeanetta Little, and she preached, what is the altar? And so I yield to you, Apostle Davison.
The altar is a physical representation of our relationship with God. Be on the lookout for idols and build an altar where we first met God.
Amen, amen. A word of God should make you think. One of the things that God has said is that this is a word that we're to play while we are on that 2 week, because it's gonna have us looking at a heart. She also preached the word of God. It was called the heart thing. It was called the heart thing. And so she taught a word regarding our heart, because our heart gotta be right to accept God in it. If our heart's not right, the altar is not going to be right. However, watch this and watch everything else. So then that way you're going to be called. You'll be able to see the things that maybe you've been doing and not doing. And this word is going to help you. Oh, hallelujah. To have that heart of God. You hear me? That heart of God. Does anyone else have anything to add? Respond the pod. Okay, now we are on Monday, May the 15th. Pastor Dickery came in and he preached, God is a consuming fire, and that I yield to you, Apostle Davison.
Be careful who you listen to. Sacrifice brings men closer to God. And we must sacrifice ourselves unto God. We must be obedient to God.
Amen. Amen. Yes, I wanted to say, I didn't say, first of all, when that what is an altar was a dynamic word, because it's helping us to learn about our heart. And Lord God, I wish Janetta was up here. We miss our anchor. She's not here though, but we love you, our sister. Man of God, God used you too when you preach the word. God is a consuming fire. To God be all the glory. It was such a word that when you taught it, God told me that there was a part two. And that, and then if you were to go and bring it forth on tonight, and you did, you brought it with the fire from the heaven above, and I thank God for it. And I do have some little things to say regarding the word that you brought tonight, but I'll wait until we get to that. Does anybody else have anything to say regarding the altar? God is a consuming fire. Did you say about of us sacrificing ourselves to God, and that how we must be obedient?
Yes.
And I hear that again.
Yes, I do.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Does anybody else have anything that they would like to add? Amen.
Amen. Amen. I like what he said, be careful who you listen to. Mm. When we at the altar, we gotta be totally open to hear God's voice. We can't have somebody in this ear or that ear, or somebody trying to get our attention. We are careful who we listen to, because God is always speaking.
Yes.
And God wants, when we at the altar of God, he wants to get us to that place where we yield ourselves totally to him, so he can continually clean us and renew us and revive us and restore us.
Amen, amen. And the next was on this past Wednesday, and it was called The Altar of God, and it was taught by Apostle Maria Castel from Switzerland.
Amen. Where sacrifice is made, where the altar of God is where sacrifice is made, where God speaks to us. The altar fire is not to go out. We are to be the altar of God, the Holy Spirit to reign, to be able to do work at all times. Distinguish holiness versus an actor. Discern who is of God and not of God.
Amen, amen. I wanted to indicate in this also that she taught us the power that we are an altar. And that goes back to even the man of God talking about the man of God talking about the characteristics that we display. What characteristics? How are we acting? Do we have God in us, or are we like burning incense? Or what are we doing? If our hearts are not in alignment with God, if our bodies are not that living sacrifice to God, we are not an altar of God, and therefore we cannot do his works or his will, because we're unholy. We are messed up. Mm-hmm. We're consumed in sin. Mm-hmm. However, that when you're the altar of God and that Holy Spirit is within you, you're going to be able to do all things through Christ Jesus. Do you hear me? All things through Christ Jesus. A powerful word of God. And that it taught, and she talked about, we should be able to see something, see someone, and distinguish whether if they are of God, if they have the Holy Spirit in them, or maybe or an actor, because she talked about how some of them will do all the puff and smoke and all of this. They'll do the pomp and circumstances, trying to, y'all seen people come up there and they got the voice tone. They got the voice, they got the mannerisms and everything, but there's absolutely no anointing there. No anointing on them at all. And when I heard this word, that's what I thought about. The people that I see, that they sound like they holy, they sound like it, but there's no anointing, there's something missing in there. It's missing. And so now, and then on Thursday, May the 18th, we had Evangelist, Missionary, and Mother Gracie Morgan, and she came with War Ruin Room, and she prayed. Mm-hmm. She prayed like she never prayed before. The woman of God, I think she done took mm-hmm. all of the teachings from the altar of God. She already off the altar. She been there, and she off, because when she prayed, there was this clear shift. Y'all hear me? A shift. Yeah. And the prayer and the anointing, oh Jesus, those demons, they got squashed. You didn't hear nothing. I mean, it was a difference that was there. And she was telling people to come to the altar of God and come. And I thank God. I was like, well, whatever she's been doing, I'm gonna go be doing it too. So, woman of God, what have you been doing? These lads, I'm yielding to you. What have you been doing?
Just staying before the Lord and just seeking Him for direction, seeking Him for direction for the times that we're in right now, the things that are getting ready to happen, mm-hmm. as well as just submitting and surrendering the more to Him and allowing Him to pour out and work, and that's what we're supposed to be. And remember, one thing I want to say is we have to remember that the altar is perpetual.
Yes,
it's a perpetual place, and that's where we need to be, just living in on that perpetual altar.
Yes,
and not deviate, not go to the side, not get in ahead of God, but just live and stay right there and listen. Be careful to listen and obey.
Amen. Amen. Well, I'm going to stay in that perpetual place. I'm going to be like, what's that song, Perpetual Praise? I'm going to be in that perpetual place and doing some perpetual praise and down on my knees perpetually during these 3 weeks, because I tell you what, I don't want to be the same. I don't want to look the same. I don't want to walk the same. I don't want to sound. I want to be dear. I want a closer relationship with the Lord God. I pray that each one of y'all do also. And when you go back and watch these teachings, when you go back and watch the encouragement of how we need to do our heart, when you look at how we need to follow after God, as Mary Jo, she taught, and you listen to every single word regarding what we need to do and not do, we're all going to walk differently. We're all going to have, oh, hallelujah, a closer relationship with God. And now we're going to go and do part one and part two of a consuming fire. So woman of God, did you want to give the nuggets that you got from today, and that we're going to do both, and then yield it back to Pastor Dicker?
Amen. The first one is, don't desecrate God's altar. And desecration means to hold in contempt. We can't bring, to minister at the altar of God, you must be licensed by an accredited pastor. License says you have experience. Just like you get your driver's license, you have to take the test to get as a licensed minister, a licensed vessel of God means you have experience. You're able to work the altar of God. And the third one is saying, God says, when we come to the altar, come with expectation of God working miracles at the altar in your own heart. Amen.
Amen. Before we turn it to you, I'm going to have you to go last, Apostle Dicker, so then that way you can respond to the things that we've added also. So I figured that's a better way to do it. Okay. Amen. One of the things that I heard you say is that God wants your best. I think that is so important at the altar. And you said that some people think about money. And when I'm sitting here thinking, when God wants our best, I'm thinking about my life. I'm found thinking about me being that living sacrifice, about me, my time that I give to him, my time, my study time, my walk, my heart, me giving me, putting me there, and that for me to be that living sacrifice, and to be able to go into commune with God. I think about the characteristics I must show, and you broke it down. You talked about showing God and about being holy and how we have to walk in holiness. I've seen some mean, evil people up in the house of God, people that don't speak, and then they want to lay hands on people. That's why what you taught and what the people of God has taught is so important, because if you can't speak to me, I can't go to you for prayer, because I don't want that spirit up on me. That we have to, and you brought that out. And one of the things too, that when you talked about, and I did want to go back and say that it's different for different states, in different jurisdictions and different churches. And so when we have the attorney here, or attorney general here, she's going to be able to maybe answer questions regarding what jurisdiction you're in. But yeah, because people are getting sued, and that watchman, that church can get sued. And you were so on point when you said they need training, because we got some untrained people out here that the people are going to get in worse condition. And one of the things I had an issue with, because and I guess it's about correction, because I was in a meeting, and that somebody was training, and they said the wrong thing that what we're supposed to do and not do. And so I turned to look at the overseer to see, you know, is this true or whatever, and nothing was said, and nobody corrected it. And so, you know what, I went out and made the mistake, and I made the mistake to the point to where God called me out in sin. He did. He said that I told you to go do this, I told you, but you didn't, because of man, what man law is. Mm-hmm. And so I had to go up and repent. It was another woman came over there, because I heard God. I was told I couldn't move or anything until I got licensed and ordained. Mm-hmm. And so I couldn't move through the Holy Spirit until I got the license and ordainment. And so I looked, and the person didn't correct it. And so I'm in church, and God is telling me to go to this woman and go tell her this. And I'm like, I can't, God. I can't. They told me I can't move. I'm not licensed and I'm not ordained at this point, so I can't. Can you get somebody else? He said, I told you to go tell her this. I'm saying, God, I can't. You told me I have to be obedient. So I'm being obedient to leadership. Yeah. And so I can't go. He said, yes, please, God, I can't. I want you to tell me I'm supposed to be obedient. I'm being obedient. And so then it was somebody singing in the choir. Apostle God, Apostle Lauren, she been up here. She came, she got this look in her eyes got so big. She started walking down from singing in the choir. And then when she did, I was like, oh, thank you, God, you done gave it to somebody else. She went over to the woman. I'm like, thank you, God, thank you, Jesus. After she left the woman, guess what? Those eyes, like there were flames, they started walking over there to me. And she bent down. She said, God said, the next time he tells you to do something, or he says that you're to do it immediately. Jesus. Mm. I went up and I repented. But I learned that day to listen to God. When God tells me to move. And I've been moving since. And when he tells me to go do something, he tells me to say something, no matter how crazy, how what it is, I'm going to say it and do it. And it's because I stay at the altar of God, making myself a sacrifice unto him. That is how he's able to say, Lord, it's me. When somebody, when stuff happens, I'm looking at me first, thinking it's my fault. And so sometimes I'm too hard on myself, and I'm looking at it. It's got to be me. I'm doing something wrong. You know, as I'm searching, God, is it me? Is it me? Mm-hmm. And I think because I have a heart for other people and I have true love and I forgive them, even when people do me wrong, I'm like, Jesus. And that I sometimes feel like it's like Sam Sausage Head wrote across my forehead, because I go back and I will forgive them and forgive them and forgive them. But God has taught me, yeah, you forgive them, but then sometimes he'll have you to break it away. So now he's teaching me to break. And so not to be that punching bag for people to treat me any kind of way. And then through it, guess what? He's given me that spiritual boldness that I need. So sometimes when something is being misspoken in church to where you know that it's not right, you better speak up. You better speak up in the name of Jesus, because lives are at stake. So pray and ask God to guide you. You got to pray and ask God to guide you. I wasn't licensed or ordained as through the body of Christ, because a lot of times when people see that you're anointed, they try to hold you back. So God will license and ordain you. However, you still need to go by what the church is saying and what the church laws and what the laws of that state is, what the laws of that church, whether if it's a Baptist or Free Will Baptist, Missionary Baptist, whatever it is, that we have to be obedient to the laws of that. And then to God. Because God will give you something. I mean, when he gave me COVID, when he gave me these storms, I'm like, Jesus, the other day, he said storms all kind. Did y'all see the storm start up on the baseball field, a thin storm? But everything that God is saying, it's coming true. But in it, you can walk in that anointing also. If you listen to the teachings that have came forth, if you go do the things that Apostle Dicker, that Apostle Sakwa, Apostle Davison, and that evangelist, missionary, and a prophet of God, missionary and all the other apostles and evangelists and prophets that God have ordained to be up here. You hear me? That you will be able to walk in newness. You'll be able to walk in your healing, your deliverance, your restoration, the renewing of your mind. You'll be able to, God will break you down. He will break you down by chastisement and correction. And then he will heal, deliver, and purge you. He will show you, and then that's when the building and the building comes and the encouragement to where we can become that new creature. And guess what? After we do, it's going to happen all over again and again. As long as we have life, we're on that wheel. And at that point, I yield to you, Apostle Dicker, for the time to reflect. I'm going to give you 4 minutes to reflect on everything that we've said. Does anybody else have anything, Reverend Sakwa or Mother Gracie, before he goes forth?
No.
Do you evangelist missionary?
No.
Okay, so we yield to you, Apostle Dicker. He's our overseer too. Okay. Yeah. So we yield to you, man of God, at this point.
Amen. Love everything that was said. What stood out to me is the perpetual prayer in that altar comes to life. Never to go out. The fire was never to go out. Mm-hmm. It's supposed to be perpetual.
Yes.
So we're to be praying constantly. Without ceasing is what the word says. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Again, as I said, some of the most powerful ministries I've seen, I found out that they got a prayer warrior somewhere, or prayers, they just pray all the time. Mm-hmm. And that's why you see the power of God. Benny Hinn ministry is one of them. Billy Graham's ministry, those people would get together and pray whenever he had to go out, something like 3 days before he went, and pray the whole time while he was preaching. And they would pray for just one thing, and that was salvation. But when he would get that salvation call, you would see the stadium empty. And I wonder why. I just said, why is he? Go ahead. I didn't understand the Holy Spirit, but then I didn't understand prayer either. So I began to study him and look at him in his biographies. He said that's what they do. And so that stood out to me. So if you want to have a powerful walk with God, a powerful ministry, mm-hmm. effective, you've got to be at the altar of prayer. You've got to spend time in prayer. It's so important. We do it for a while and then we get away from it. We get busy. And sometimes when we get, I heard Benny Hinn say something when he got real popular, he was staying at someone's house and God was unctioning him to come and pray. And he's like, no, I want to stay in tower. I want to stay in tower. God was unctioning him to pray. And he said, no, I just want to stay. And he didn't want to leave his company. And that night when he preached, no power. God said, next time I call you, you come. He said, you ain't got time for me. I ain't got time to spend with you. Because whatever you do in private, it's going to show in public. I said that mm-hmm. earlier. You know, and holiness is so important. But I don't know how we got away from holiness. Somebody was mentioning about going in the clubs and then coming in the church trying to minister.
yeah.
I don't know. Ministering salvation with, what do you think they was? Was at the club. Like, nah, don't touch me. Be upset. So it's so important to be holy. And that's not the only way. I mean, that's just one of the other way is to be cleansed. That's what the altar was about. Sacrifice, cleansing, being cleansed, holy and acceptable unto God. That's his will. His perfect will is to be right in that heart. In that heart is so important. But one thing is God is saying to me in all this, he's saying this, and I hear him so clearly. He said, tell my people I love them. Mm-hmm. I always say that, you know, he loves you very much, but he says this, and this is what got my attention. He says, tell them to repent while they mm-hmm. still have breath in their body. And then he began mm-hmm. to repeat, I'm coming soon. I'm coming mm-hmm. soon. I'm coming soon. Mm. God is soon mm. to return. We're in a time now. I don't think people realize where we are. You know, some people say we ain't in the four horsemen, and I taught on that. You see all this violence going on. We are here, and God is soon to come. And so we must stay ready, and he's calling his people to repent, you know, and that's why he's got revivals going to bring his people back, to revive them, to get excited. Mm. And he wants you not to let that fire go down. But to keep that fire going, to go in prayer, separate yourself. You know, mm-hmm. that's what holy is. Separate yourself. Yeah. Go somewhere and pray. Spend time with God. Get yourself strong again that you don't let them dominate the conversation, but you dominate the conversation. They don't influence you. You influence them. And that's one of the things I noticed about the church in the last, I'm going to say, 15 years, is that the world is influencing the church. Everything they do, we do. And that's not God's. We should be influenced, but there's not enough power in the church. There's no presence of God because I'm not saying nobody, but a lot of us is not spending time at the altar. Mm-hmm. You know, we come together with God, God would change things. He wants that revival. God wants this. David, he loves you. So I'm telling you, repent while you still have time. You've heard the word of God go forth for, what, is it 2 weeks now, Bonnie?
Yes, sir.
Mm-hmm. About the altar. You know, and a lot of times when I'm praying, what Pastor Sakwa was saying, God will say, tear down the altar. I said, huh? He said, tear down the altar. And, you know, so people are praying against us. And, you know, they're burning sage and they got all these crazy incense, killing chickens at the altar, at their altar of prayer, because they're worshiping other gods. They're putting blood, you know, that God has already fulfilled all that. So the devil, he's an antichrist. He does everything that God does, you know, he reverses it. So God don't want a sacrifice of an animal now. He wants a sacrifice of your heart. He wants you to submit him everything that's going on with you so that he can use it. And I'm gonna close by saying, God loves you. Repent while you still can. You don't know the hour or the moment of your death, and you don't know the hour or the moment of his return. So get it together while you still quit making excuses. When I get this right, when I get that right, you ain't never gonna get it right because you don't have the power to do it. That's why he sent the Holy Spirit. He will give you the Holy Spirit to comfort you, to lead you, to guide you, to teach you his ways. Amen.
That's powerful. I thank you. One of the other things that I've learned from the man of God, my overseer also, and is that when he says to move in God's power was another nugget that he had spoke on, but things are going to happen such as the enemy, God is going to give Satan permission to test us. And so things are going to come through trials, through tribulations, through chaos, through confusion. It's going to come through, try to come through the internet, through transportation, through technology, your cell phones, your family, your marriage, your children, your grandchildren, family members, through your health, through your job, through even the church, through any situation, the community. And so what you have to do, and that's why it's so important that we stay at the altar and develop that relationship, because it doesn't matter what anybody else says or does, that we're supposed to show and represent the characteristic of God at all times, because people are looking and that they're watching. And the teachings that has been going forth these last 2 weeks of the altar of God is going to help you to be able to be an altar of God, to be able for you to know and distinguish a true altar of God, for you to be equipped to tear down evil altars, to be able to rebuke, bind up, and cast out in the name of Jesus, for you to be able to speak things into existence, to be able to do, as Philippians 4:13 says, I can do all things through Christ Jesus that strengthens me. If you don't know Christ, if you haven't accepted him, you cannot. And there's no power more mightier than the Lord God. We're going to be gone for 3 weeks. And during this 3 weeks time, we're going to check, Apostle Davison and I, we're going to check in on you. We're going to pop in and everything. We always say a few minutes, but sometimes God, you don't. Elder Janetta, she was teaching. She said, you know, y'all not going to be up here just 5 minutes, Bonnie. And so, we plan on being there, just popping in the way God says, but we don't release until God releases us. And at this point, we're coming to a close, and I'm going to go to each person for last words. Each person, you have 2 minutes for any last words, and I'm going to go across my screen as Pastor Dicker, then Reverend Sakwa, then Pastor Davison, and then Evangelist. Okay, Apostle Dicker, I'm going to you first. Any last minutes, words?
Just the same as before. Repent. Get right with God because he loves you and he's soon to come. And thank y'all for the opportunity to minister to the people of God from God. God bless you and keep you. Amen.
God bless you too, man of God. Reverend Robert Sakwa.
Thank you. As servants of God, we should make sure that we maintain the altar. We maintain ourselves to be holy, to be righteous before God. Remember the Eli, the priest. The Bible says he operated under closed heaven because when his children began to defile the altar, misusing the altar things, and sinning against God by taking women. The Bible says they faced the consequences, they faced the wrath of God when they all died, when the Ark of the Tabernacle was taken by the Philistines. So as servants of God, that's why you can see most children of pastors go the opposite direction because of the altar. When you rebel against that altar, doing things against the altar of God, it works against you. It will work against your generation. So we must be, as a servant of God has said, that standard of holiness, we must maintain that and be obedient each and every time to hear from God. God bless you so much.
God bless you too, man of God, and thank you. Apostle
Davison. Make sure your altar is holy. Make sure your altar does not contain any idols. Make sure your fire and your sacrifice is pure.
Amen.
Amen. Evangelist Missionary Mother Gracie.
There's always room at the altar. For those who may not know the Lord, now is the time. Now is the time. He's standing, waiting with open arms. He wants everyone to be saved. Everyone to be saved. And when you accept him, submit and surrender, find a Bible-believing church where the word is being preached and taught without compromise.
Amen. To God be all the glory. And I just want to say again, don't be looking all around. This is a time for us to look at ourselves, and that for us to be holy, sanctified, and that for us to be, to put ourselves on the altar as that sacrifice to God, to ask God to do that spiritual search on us, to ask God to come into our hearts, to ask God to cleanse out spiritual wax, anything that's gonna stop us from hearing him. I want you to grow. God gave me a command or a commission, and he told me to teach everyone what I know and what I've been taught to be able to walk in a fivefold ministry. And I'm trying my best. And sometimes I get hit, slapped, beat down. However, I don't care. I'm the energizer bunny through God. I'm going to keep on ticking with the help of the Lord God. Oh, hallelujah. And that's what you do. God will give you that endurance, that power to keep going, to keep that, what is it? Take that licking and keep on ticking. Yes, that's it. And that's a watch too. Yeah, a Timex. Yeah. However, I want you to grow in God. Stay with us. Join us on Ministerial Engagement. We're on THCN TV too. God is doing some awesome things. We are on YouTube, Twitter, on Tumblr, and oh, hallelujah. And we'll be on Roku soon. To God be all the glory. And we need your help. Share today's broadcast, okay? Share. And we're going to lastly, two things. We're going to go and have altar prayer. Evangelist Missionary Morgan, she's going to do a come to the altar. And then I will be yielding to Apostle Precious, and she's going to pray the prayer for the man of God and all of us to be refilled, and then the benediction. So I yield to you, Evangelist Missionary Morgan. Yes.
Praise God. Father, we thank you for this revival, Father. We pray that it is received in the spirit in which it was given. In the name of Jesus, we thank you, Father. We thank you, Father. Cause the people to know that this message is from you, Father. Help us, Father, to continue to have respect for your altar. In the name of Jesus, Father. And we just thank you, Father. We thank you for who you are, Father. We thank you for your altar, Father. In the name of Jesus, Father. In the name of Jesus, Father. We thank you, Father, for giving us a desire to live on the perpetual altar.
Yes, Father.
The perpetual altar, Father. In the name of Jesus, we just praise you, Father. We thank you, Father. Thank you, Father, for revealing to us, Father, that the altar is tangible as well as intangible. And right now, we invite each and every one that's under the sound of my voice to come to the altar. There's always room at the altar. Now is the time. Now is the time. We invite each and every one into the family of God. And we thank you, Father. We thank you for this section of the revival that you have given us, Father. In the name of Jesus. 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 We thank you, Father. We thank you, Father. We thank you, Father. We thank you for each and every one that we are interceding for, Father. Everyone, Father, that's in need of prayer, and needed prayer. And I speak to everyone that's on the sound of my voice, submit and surrender. Submit and surrender before it's everlasting too late. Seek him while he may be found. He's waiting with open arms. He's waiting with open arms. And for Father, we thank you. We just thank you. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
Amen. And I also wanted to thank, amen, thank you, woman of God, for the prayer. Thank you, Apostle Davison, for co-facilitating. Thank you, Reverend Robert Sakwa, for being here. I know it's like 4 a.m. there in Kenya. I thank God for your dedication. I thank God for you, Apostle Dicker, and just being who you are, a mighty man of God. I thank God for you, those of you that are followers of Jesus Christ, those of you that watch and grow, those of you that love the Lord, those of you that share. I thank God for each and every one of you. And during this 3 weeks, y'all just be blessed in the name of Jesus. I yield to you, Apostle Davison. And a happy birthday. It's going to be Apostle Davison's birthday on Tuesday also. So happy birthday, woman of God. We'll be checking in on y'all. We love you. Oh, hallelujah. This has been an awesome talk show. To God be all the glory, and an awesome way to end part one of Altar of God's Revival, and as we go into part two on tomorrow, and y'all won't see us, but we'll be in the will of God. I yield to you, woman of God. Amen.
Amen. Father, we come lifting up the man of God who brought forth the second part, to God is a consuming fire. Actually, restore all virtue that he gave out from the crown of his head to the very soles of his feet. In the name of Jesus, replenish, oh God. Strengthen his body, oh God. Strengthen his mind, strengthen his heart, strengthen his spirit, oh God. Protect him on every side, oh God, with your precious blood, even now, Lord God. In the name of Jesus, as he goes forth continually, spreading the good news of Jesus Christ. Wherever he goes, Lord God, restore all virtue to Apostle Bonnie, Pastor Sakwa, Evangelist Missionary, and myself, in the name of Jesus. Father God, just cover us in your blood, oh God, in the name of Jesus. And as we depart, oh God, and coming back in 3 weeks, oh God, cover our mind, cover our hearts, cover our spirits, cover our homes and our families, oh God, in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and our Savior. Oh God, just keep us in care, in Jesus' majesty and mighty name. Now unto him who was able to keep him from falling, and to present fathers before the coming of his glory with exceeding joy, be dominion and power and majesty both now and forever, in Jesus' name. Amen. And amen.
Amen. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Everybody be blessed. Oh, hallelujah. Have an awesome time in the Lord. Our God is awesome. We'll see y'all in 3 weeks. Mm. Y'all have a blessed night. Amen. Good night. Amen. 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 Amen.